Everything seemed to be going according to plan. Harold regrouped his men and he told them to stand firm. But then a cry came up. William had fallen. And down in this part of the battlefield, the Normans appeared to be in some disarray, pulling back. On Harold's right flank, the Saxon discipline broke, and they came pouring down the hillside.
Although several horses had been killed beneath him, William was very much alive. He threw back his helmet so that his troops could see him, and he ordered them to return to battle and butcher the oncoming Saxons.
William continued to make a series of feigned retreats, luring the Saxons down from their hilltop position to isolated places below, where they were encircled and trapped and hacked apart by the Normans. King Harold and his close guard could only look on in horror as before their very eyes their countrymen were massacred, including two of Harold's own brothers.
After 8 hours, Harold himself was killed, shot in the eye by an arrow. And then the Normans went for full victory, charging up the ridge and dealing Harold's army the final blow. On hearing the terrible news of the death of their king, the Saxons turned and fled into the woods. By nightfall, it was all over. Harold's mutilated body was buried without ceremony on the beach where William had landed. And when Harold's mother offered gold to the Duke to reclaim her son, she was refused.
But the conquest was far from complete. True, the Godwin clan had been destroyed, but there was still plenty of Saxon resistance, grouped around the bishops and the northern earls. They were determined to avenge the murder of their king.
William advanced through the southern towns, plundering and burning the centres of Anglo-Saxon England. His message was clear: collaborate or die. By the time the Norman army had reached Winchester, Edith, Harold's sister, simply handed over the keys to the city. There was one final target.
William knew that unless he took control of London, he wouldn't hold on to England. But so fearsome was his reputation that all it took was for him to encircle the city and it capitulated. Then he met with the leading Saxon nobles and archbishops at a place called Berkhamsted, where they offered him their surrender and their oath of loyalty. On Christmas Day 1066, in Westminster Abbey, William was crowned the King of England.
Even then, his position was not secure. There were Saxon rebellions for the next 5 years. Exeter held out for 8 days against a Norman siege. The most powerful counterattack came in York. When the citizens rose up here, thousands were gruesomely killed, bodies left to fester, and William celebrated Christmas among the ruins of a starving city. But William was not only a destroyer, he was also a builder, chiefly of castles manned by nobles loyal only to his cause, to keep watch over England. Dotted throughout his territory, they are his legacy, symbols of conquest. The Tower of London was begun by William, built with stones shipped all the way from France. William transformed how England was governed. 5,000 Saxon lords were disinherited. The native English were now the underclass. William knew that power was not just about terror, it was also about information. At Christmas 1085, while holding court in Gloucester, he ordered a census to catalogue life in England. County by county, the Doomsday Book lists who owned what, who lived where, the basis of wealth and power. England was no longer a nation of Saxon smallholders. This was the beginning of a centralized state, with everything accountable to the king. William died as he'd lived, from injuries sustained in battle, defending Normandy to the last. On his deathbed, his rage was finally spent. He even expressed remorse for the way that he'd treated the English. "I fell on the English of the northern counties like a raving lion. I subjected them to the calamity of a cruel famine, and by doing so became the barbarous murderer of many thousands, young and old." 21 years after he was crowned the King of England, William would be buried here, at Conn in Normandy. This was where he belonged. For him, the England that he'd conquered would only ever be a province of his native homeland. But his death hardly matched the triumph of his life. He had become obscenely fat, so that when they came to pack his body into the tomb, it burst, and the whole cathedral reeked. Propelled by anger, always haunted by knowing that he was a bastard son and had something to prove, William had an unquenchable appetite for territory and power. And yet this most bloodthirsty and feared king also wanted justice and order. He was the conqueror, but he was also the lawbringer. After William, England would never be the same again.